and welcome to the latest in the Leaders with Ambition podcast series. And today I'm delighted to welcome my guest, Peter Skinner. Peter is currently Business Development and Marketing Director at Wedlake Bell, and he's also LMA Europe board member, which is something that he'll discuss a little bit later on in the podcast. Really quite an amazing organisation. I think from this podcast today, there's going to be so much that comes through. The real sense of authenticity that shines through from Peter, and also the way that he really invests in his people and how much enjoyment he gets from developing people. And that's something he's done throughout his career. And I know there's lots of people out there that say exactly the same thing to me as well. So it's always good to hear. It will shine through talking about, again, the knowledge that he has and how knowing your value and contribution to a firm will make such a big difference. And that's what partners are looking for. And also the power of building networks. And again, this is essential in lots of different organizations. It's essential in lots of different careers. But I think also in the business development and marketing world, it seems to be even more so. Hence why he does a lot of work now with the LMA, which, as I mentioned, we'll talk about. So without further ado, Peter, over to you to bring your career history to life for us.
Thanks, Nicky. Lovely to be here. Thanks for having me on. It's a real pleasure. I'm born and bred West London, lived in this neck of the woods all my life, went to school here, and really have not moved particularly far from where I was brought up. So West London, got the city close to me. My brother worked in the city for insurance, and I guess that I always felt at some point or other there was an option of me going towards the city for work. But I was also playing rugby a lot, and I've played rugby a lot for a long time. And so I guess, you know, having that sporting background is something I've always enjoyed doing early in my career, from when I was sort of six or seven, being involved in Wasps Rugby Club, as actually it was. Has really set me up through everything I've done to really where I am today. And that sporting background is, I guess, part of what I am.
So, and I can see the shirts behind you on the wall. So I take it those were some of your playing days, were they?
They are from my playing days. I was very fortunate to play a good level of rugby. So those shirts are representative rugby shirts. So from playing for London and South East England, and I was fortunate enough to represent England schools at schoolboy level as well.
Fantastic.
It's kind of part of my life and part of what's been about me and driven me through my career. Kind of fell into marketing and business development. I was playing rugby to a good level, had an opportunity potentially to play pro rugby. My age, and everyone will guess my age now, my age was such that I was part of both the amateur rugby period, but also then the professional rugby period. And I got offered a contract, in effect, to play rugby for Wasps professionally when I was still, or had started working at Herbert Smith. So I basically left school, played rugby, and fallen into a role at Herbert Smith through an agency. I didn't know what I wanted to do, had no real career plans, had no real career guidance at school. And so I found myself taking a contract role in an administration position at Herbert Smith, what's now HSF.
Yeah.
And was fortunate enough to have one of the partners there who was a sports lawyer. And I gave him my contract that at that time, very early on in rugby, professional rugby, was about, I think it was about 200 pages long. It was ridiculous. Gave him his contract and he said, well, look, I can't really advise you professionally, but whatever you do, don't sign it.
Right. And so, great advice, I'm sure. Yeah.
Exactly. So it was a bit of a very early in that kind of time of professional rugby. So I was sort of stuck between a rock and a hard place. Do I try and continue playing rugby or do I work and earn a proper living? And I was good, but I probably wasn't good enough to do that pro piece. So I chose to carry on in the career that I'd fallen into at Herbert Smith. And that was nearly 30 years ago.
And you're still in that career. So obviously it was a good choice.
Yeah, I put a few pounds on. I've lost some hair. Some of the hair that's there has got a bit grayer. But very much, if you look back 30 years, I'm still in it. I must be in it for a reason. I love it. I've enjoyed it. It's been really good for me as an individual. But it's given me a lot in terms of reward. And you were talking earlier on there about what it is that interests me and keeps me going and where my values are.
Yeah.
And it's about people. And that's why I talked about the rugby bit to begin with. People, rugby is a team sport. And actually what I think we do in marketing BD is a team sport. And to take those values and take what I learned into my professional career and to bring that from the Herbert Smith piece right the way through now to where I am at Wedlake Bell as a BD and marketing director, I think has shaped the person I am and how I like running teams and why I want people to feel to be part of a team when they're in a professional services role.
Yeah. And I know that when we've talked in the past, your time at Herbert Smith was a time that really did mould and change you. And you also studied for your CIM, your professional qualification. That was important for you to achieve that, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, I didn't do the traditional education, you know, go and do a degree straight out of school. I had this kind of rugby and work thing. And so when I made the decision, okay, rugby's not going to pay the bills and, you know, get a roof over my head and all these sorts of things. And I committed to working in a professional services role. I then realized I needed to have that education, that further education piece behind me.
Yeah.
And it was as much needed from a credibility perspective within the business as it actually was from a personal perspective for me. I always found myself in the career I was in talking to people who were, you know, were at various unis, talked about their degrees, talked about what they'd done. And I always found myself doing what I've just spent a few minutes doing, falling back onto rugby. Mm-hmm. And I felt a little bit of an imposter, actually.
Yeah.
And so it was a real personal thing for me to prove that I had the ability to go and learn, to do further education, to go and get that professional qualification. And so went on and did my Chartered Institute of Marketing exams and did that when I was working at Herbert Smith. And
yeah.
For me, it was a really personal thing. In hindsight, actually, and now, does it for me now really make a difference? Not really, other than from a personal perspective.
Yeah.
But back then, for me, it was really valuable.
Yeah, but I think it's also really inspirational for people that, you know, aren't going through what, as you just classed them, the traditional A-levels, university, first job. And actually, I think that's becoming rarer. And, you know, if you look at the cost of people going to university these days, that apprenticeships is a really valued and valid method of developing and really enhancing your career. So I think it'd be good for people to see and hear that you've achieved a really senior role and haven't gone down that traditional route. So well done you.
I think that's right. I mean, it's important that education is important. Don't get me wrong. I've just packed my eldest off to university and it was very, very encouraging. And I use the word encouraging with a push. Very encouraging on getting to go to university. I think there is absolutely the right place for it, particularly more so now. But there are different routes to achieving your goals. And it's very easy, particularly in the profession we're in, to be intimidated by the planet-sized brains that you're surrounded by.
Yeah.
And the actually having confidence in yourself, confidence in those around you, that you're good at what you do know your stuff, that you've got something to bring and you've got value to bring to a business, isn't always about the fact that you've got BA, BSc or whatever behind your name. There are different routes to deliver this. And actually experience is also critically important in success.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point there, Peter. And after Herbert Smith, you made the decision to move to Watson Farley Williams and obviously got a promotion with that move as well. What was the reason for moving to a different firm?
So Herbert Smith had started very much in the admin, I mean, right at the bottom, literally the traditional right at the bottom,
yeah.
And worked my way through four different roles at Herbert Smith, I think it was. To become a marketing, I think I was marketing executive by the time I left, and just chopping departments. So I wasn't in marketing when I started, I was in admin and found myself in marketing after, you know, a year or so, and then moved within the marketing team doing different roles. I've done 6 years in my first role. And that, I think, particularly—
Long time.
Long time. And I had really, whilst I had variety of exposure to types of work, I had no variety of exposure to types of business or type of people, I'd become very, very much comfortable in what I was doing.
Right.
I didn't really actually know what was out there. I mean, bear in mind, this is nearly 30 years. There were four of us in the entire BD and marketing function at Herbert Smith.
Unbelievable, isn't it?
It's terrifying. and it was, we were finding our own way. And the 6 years that I did there, the team grew, what was needed grew, the role grew, but I was finding myself not really growing with it.
Yeah.
And I thought the best way to move and to develop was by, well, to develop was by moving. And so I stopped to look and then found myself at Watson Farley Williams in a, what I would then class as a proper marketing executive role. The first role within a dedicated marketing BD function with a marketing BD director, with an events element, with a pitching element, with all the beginnings of the nuts and bolts that you start to see in modern day professional services and BD, marketing BD function in law firms, despite the fact there were probably still only five of us in it.
Yeah.
So it's still very small, but the beginnings of what was needed to deliver for a professional services law firm.
Yeah, very embryonic, wasn't it then?
And
again, it was a role that I know you really got a lot of value from, didn't you? Something that you felt that you were constantly learning, which I know is really important to you.
It was. It gave me the opportunity to do things I'd never done. So yeah. I've been very much a reactive person at Herbert Smith, partially because that was the way the business was run and that was marketing. At Watson Farley Williams, it was the first time you really started, I really started to be proactive, to start doing things that was taking them to the partners and taking them to the business, as well as learning pitching inside out, as well as learning how to run an event. It was the very much the basics of what you see today.
Nice.
Learning those skills and actually starting to learn to build the relationships with the partners as well. So it wasn't just the technical, what do we do?
Yeah.
It became a, how do we do it? How do we influence? How do I start to become somebody who in this business, despite the fact I was relatively junior, still had the ability to go to partners or others within the business and make a difference? And that was really where it started to be that I've become that person. And I started to see that I'd learned things and things that I was bringing to the business was making a difference.
And I think you also mentioned when you were there, it was such an open environment with the partnership group, wasn't it? So they were really encouraging and for people to learn, which again, people are very busy, particularly partners. So it's great organisation, great firm to be able to go through that learning process with.
It wasn't just the partners. It was actually the team I was in. It was with the marketing director there, who was quite specific in what he wanted from you.
Right, okay.
He gave you the opportunity to go and try things.
Yeah.
To go and make a mistake.
Yeah.
And not to be vilified for making a mistake. And actually, that's something that I've lived through and lived by, continue to live by now.
Is it's so important.
Because they're good mistakes.
Yeah.
And if you're going to make a mistake, make a good one.
Yeah. Very true. And don't keep making the same mistake either.
Don't make the same one. That's exactly true.
Learn. Always learn. So you had obviously a great experience there and decided it was time to move to Slaughter and May. And that again was something that I think you were quite focused then about the steps that you were making in your career, weren't you, and the sort of firms that you wanted to work for.
I was. I mean, there was a little bit of fortune at this point as well, because I was looking to move, but got made redundant while I was looking to move, actually. And so I very fortunately was about to resign and got made redundant a week before I was going to resign. So honestly, kept fairly quiet.
Yeah, these things sometimes work for the best, don't they?
Exactly. And so was fortunate to be able to, I just had my first son at that point.
Yeah.
So I got 3 months between roles, spent 3 months with my youngest, and then walked into a role at Slaughter and May, which at that time was actually a maternity cover.
Oh, so it was right.
A 9 month mat cover. But I took the opportunity, I took it as a, and this was for me the first really big firm.
Yeah.
The one that really had a brand that sat behind it. And if you're going to go in anywhere, Slaughter.
So big.
No. Incredible firm. Absolutely incredible firm. I've got a lot of affinity for the place because of how it shaped me.
Yeah.
And because of the, particularly actually the marketing director who I worked alongside there, who is probably one of the ones who's influenced me most in my career. And we'll probably talk a bit about that in a minute.
Yeah.
But the choice to move to Slaughter and Maid was a really easy one, actually. When you look at the clients, you look at the type of work, you look at the level of role that I went into. So I went in to be a manager at Slaughter and Maid. So I went from executive to manager. There was none of this senior exec coordinator, none of this multiple structures. There were probably only four or five levels maybe at that point.
And did you feel ready to step into that more senior role as well? Because again, you'd started to work with people, I know, and you were mentoring and developing people. Yeah. As well. Were you ready?
Was I ready? I don't know that I knew if I was ready.
Yeah.
I took the opportunity. Yeah, I took the opportunity. I'd done 6 years at Slaughter's, 3 years at Watson, sorry, 6 years at Herbert Smith, 3 years at Watson Farley. And so I'm like 9 years or so into a career of which a big chunk of it has been really junior. And now I'm going into a manager role at Slaughter and Maid. Do I really know what I'm letting myself in for? Honestly, no, I didn't.
Yeah.
It was all shiny, it was all exciting. And I just thought, I'm just gonna go for it. And that was the mentality I had back then. So it was a lucky move as much as anything.
And you mentioned there, you know, the very inspirational manager Anna Jacobs that you had there, and that she was a massive influence on you and subsequently on the way that you grow and manage. How did it feel to have somebody there that, you know, you were able to learn so much from and has helped shape you?
So Anna Jacobs was probably the person that really made me want to do this. I want to be where I am today, because what Anna instilled in me was the team piece. It was the management of people. It was the support, it was the culture, it was the environment that she created. I remember being involved in a big pitch fairly early on in my time at Slaughter and Maid. And I was there literally overnight, classic Slaughter and Maid, overnighter, arrive at work at 7 a.m. on Tuesday morning and you get home at 5 p.m. on Wednesday morning.
Dedication.
Anna was shoulder to shoulder with me for the entire night, working with me, supporting me, being there with me. Was one of those people who went, if you're here, I'm here. And actually, that's something that really stuck with me. The time that she invested in me and the well-being care that she had for me and the support sort of structure she put in there for me really hit home. And it wasn't until probably a few years later, I really started to appreciate how that had impacted me. Because sitting here now today, you learn so much from the good people that you work with. And you learn so much from the people that aren't quite so good. And they both shape the person you are.
Yeah.
And very much shape the positive, supportive, cultural piece with me. That was about create the environment and the people you work with and that work alongside you and with you will perform and deliver, because you create an environment that is breeds success. It shows willing, it gets people to go the extra mile for you because they support you. And it makes, I talked about those mistakes.
Yeah.
It reduces the fear factor. It reduces the worry that individuals have about making those errors. Doesn't mean to say, like you said, you don't learn from them, but actually it makes a learning environment very much the one that people want to be in. And I think that's what people really thrive on.
Big thank you to Anna there, I'd say that. But I know that you actually have lived and breathed that philosophy as well with your teams moving forward, haven't you? And I've met some of the people that have worked for you in the past and they all definitely say that. So that's, I think it was a lesson well learned early on in your career, wasn't it? Which is fantastic. And then you moved on. And I know it was, a decision that you made to move on to an A&O, which again, huge, amazing firm. Why? You're at Slaughter and Maid. Why are you moving to A&O?
It's a really good question. It, for me, it was a, I'm going to call it a bump in the road.
Yeah.
A cracking firm, brilliant firm, you know, but just such a beast, so big. Why did I move? It was one of those ones where there was absolutely a financial element.
Yeah.
So Slaughter May did have, probably not so much now, but did have a, we're Slaughter May, why would you want to go? From a firm perspective.
Right.
And so it was I felt like I needed to move to progress in my career. I was in the finance BD practice at Slaughter & May, and that was what I did for 3+ years.
Mm.
And I felt like I was becoming a little bit of a one-trick pony.
Yeah.
That said, I moved into the international capital markets, international capital markets practice of A&O. So look back, Peter, and think about what you did and why you did it, and question yeah. why you did it. However, I hoped it would be an opportunity to spread my wings and to do something a bit different. It was a bump in the road. Everybody, and actually that's something that is important to get across, I think, here. A bump in the road is okay. A bump in the road is okay as long as you learn from the bump in the road and you understand what it is that didn't really quite fit you. And for me, it was the Goliath that was A&O in terms of size. I was a very, very small fish in a very, very, very big pond.
Yeah.
And I was at that point, I'd gone from being at Slaughter's where I was influential, where I was negotiating with partners, where I was shaping and driving things and moving things forward to a very reactive role. And the reactive role just, can you do this? And I'd ask why, and it didn't matter. And I don't like not knowing why. There has to be a why in everything that we do. And that why was missing. And it frustrated me. And so it just became the sort of the big beast that I'd moved to that I thought, actually, I've learned that I don't like these situations where I'm not influential and I've not got a voice and I'm just being told to do something.
Which goes back to your value system, doesn't it? Because again, you need to be able to give value. You need to make sure you're making that contribution. I know those are all things that you hold quite dear. So if someone's just saying you do it because this is what we do, it must have been incredibly frustrating and difficult for you.
It was. But in the same way, I look back at it now with a view that it's shaped me. It's made me understand what I want and what I don't want. And when I talk to people who want to come and work with me, I'm really open on the type of environment they're coming into. Whether it's been when I've been when I was at BCLP, which we'll come on to in a minute, or whether it's where I am now at Wedlake Bell, where you couldn't get two vastly different sizes of firms or cultures, really. And so it's important that it shapes not just me, but it shapes the environment you create. And you make it very clear to people what they're coming into. So they're coming in with their eyes open.
And do you think that was also where you decided about what culture you wanted to create and that you wanted to be part of? Because I know that was, you know, jumping forward a bit to your modern day role. Mm. But, you know, that cultural element and growing and developing and making something special is incredibly important to you. Did that help shape you then into what culture should look like for you?
I think it did. And I think it was also the Slaughter & May role. So, but I hadn't realised it then.
Right.
I think what it did is it showed me the Slaughter & May piece that Anna created and then the A&O piece. And I went, oh, I like that. Oh, that's not quite so much for me. But I hadn't really appreciated what I liked until I really appreciated what I didn't like.
Yeah.
And they were equally powerful. So, yes, I think that those two contrasts for me were very much the moment where I went, okay, I now know what I think I like. And the direction I want to go in, I need to look out for these flags. I need to look out for these signposts that shape where I'm going to go in future.
It's amazing how powerful culture can be, isn't it?
It really is.
Very strong. And then you moved, so you made the decision that it was the time for you to move on. And I know you moved to IBB, which is much more local to you. And it also coincided with your family being young and you wanting to spend more time at home with your family, which I think is a really great choice. Lots of people make it now. Wasn't as usual then. So what was the driver behind that for you?
I mean, you're right. It was arrival of son number two. So IBB is in West London. So it's instead of being 25 stops into the city on the tube, it's 4 stops the other direction.
Sounds amazing.
Very local firm to me. a pretty well-known firm in my neck of the woods, and a marketing BD function that was something that I recognised, and the role came up through an agency, and the agent put two and two together. They said, oh, you live here, this is where IBB is, you'd be a good fit. And I had all the skill sets, all the experience. Mm-hmm. I wasn't happy at A&O, and so there were lots of things that aligned at the same time to make it a good move. Driven predominantly by the arrival of son number two and wanting to be able to not absolutely put the hours in like I was putting in at A&O.
Yeah, having that involvement in your family is really important to you.
Absolutely. And it was a firm that gave me the ability to do that.
And then you decided, I'm going back into London.
So the boys, the youngest one got to the point where we went to school. My wife decided that I was a pain in the backside when I was around the house too much, so she was quite happy for me to rock back into the city. I decided to look. And that's when BLP came up. And this is now January 2012.
Yeah.
So I took the jump to go to BLP. Big firm. Well, so this is where the learning from before came in. Not a huge firm like A&O, more akin to Slaughter's in terms of size. Not a small firm like IBB, but with a marketing director who I really liked. I was interviewed by two partners who I will name check, who was Russell Clifford and Adam Dan, who are still at BCLP, who were outstanding and who just made me feel like this is the place I want to be. And they, oh my goodness, did they test me? I mean, they put me through the ringer, and we laugh about it now. We absolutely do, because it was one of those ones where all of a sudden I realized I knew my stuff. And I realized I had the confidence to do this. And I was really happy going toe to toe with them. And it was fun and it was exciting. And I enjoyed the interview, as did they. And I think that was a real telling factor in why I went into BLP, because I realized that here were two very senior partners who were willing to be challenged, who wanted to have somebody not just be a dumping ground to do stuff. They wanted pushback. And so they got pushback in the interview, and they got pushback for the following 11 years.
The poor things. Brilliant. They probably rude that day.
I hope they wouldn't. I got some really nice, I had some really nice conversations with them when I eventually did leave BCLP, which actually they both look back at that moment as well.
Oh, that's interesting.
They both remember it.
Yeah.
And it's really part of what made me go to BLP was the culture, that partner openness, the great people who were there in the marketing and the BD team as well, and just an environment that I thought this is more like the Slaughter and May environment that I loved.
It did.
Mm-hmm. Some wonderful marketing BD people at that time, some of whom are still there, and just a brilliant opportunity. And so I absolutely jumped at that one.
And your career again grew considerably during that period of time and through the merger as well. I know you were heavily involved in some of the work around the merger, weren't you? Which again, fantastic experience and learns for you.
Absolutely. I mean, I joined as a BD manager for the finance practice. Here I am still. Finance. I'm still going to get away from it. But 2 years after joining, I was made head of business development. So that was internal promotion. Mm-hmm. So I had the overarching remit for BD. And this was the really first moment where business development and marketing were entities that were operated in that way, with a marketing director overseeing it, but still working together as one whole function. So I had the remit of looking after the BD function for all of BLP, which was across, I think it was 9 offices, including in Asia, Middle East, nothing in the US at that point, Europe, and a team of about 40.
Big team, and lots of time zones there.
Lots of time zones, quite a bit of travel, really exciting. And then conversations started happening with regards to the merger
with
Brian Cave. At a point in time pre that merger, I was brought in by the marketing director, as were the other senior people in the team, and let into the shop in terms of what was going on. And then some of us worked closely with our counterparts in the US, the Brian K counterparts, to start looking at how we delivered a marketing and a BD function. But one of the jobs that I was given was to take the entire BD function across both firms and create a structure for the new merged entity.
And now that's a big job, Peter.
Yeah, and not many people know I did that, including some of the other directors who may be listening to this going, oh my God, it's your fault. But part of that structure was put to the leadership team by me and my two CMOs, co-CMOs at that point. Whether or not it was public knowledge that it was put to paper by me, I don't know. But that was really, I felt really, really responsible for the not just the structure, but the roles that people were going to move in. When it was the first time I'd been through a merger that had succeeded. Lots of times I've been and we've kind of got to the gates, we'd held hands with people, we'd probably kissed through the fence, but we'd never really moved next door.
Yeah.
And this was the first time we'd moved into the house next door. And to take what was then, I think it was about 70 people across, I think it was a 30 odd offices, and to try and not only work out what do we need, but also where are they and where's the lion's share of the work going to be. The really interesting thing about a merger of the BCLP merger, the Brian K BLP merger, is that you still only had 7 offices that were BLP. There were 20 plus, majority of those dotted around the US, with maybe 2 or 3 people in each office in the US. So you've got a concentration of about 40 to 50 people in London. And then you've got similar sort of number spread all over the US. And actually trying to create a structure that was fit for purpose to deliver for departments, for practices, for time zones, for offices was
challenging, I would imagine.
One of those challenging things.
Yeah.
Because I was going to break some eggs and I was going to upset some people.
Yeah.
And there was no way around it. And you just had to accept the fact that you'd be given this job to do, and you had to do the best you could do of it.
And a big job, so you have to do, it's high profile, isn't it? And so did you, when you were doing that job, did you then think, actually, I've arrived, I am this person, this senior person that, you started off your career at Herbert Smith in admin and transferred over to marketing. At what stage did you actually feel that you were owning your career?
It was probably being made head of BD at BLP.
Yeah.
But that point where you're given, where you've got the trust of senior people to do that sort of job, and where you're in a room with 15 people from directors across the world from a merged firm, and you are negotiating, shaping the direction, not just of your team, but actually of the business. Is the moment where you think, I've come a long way.
Yeah.
It's, you can probably see me smiling about it. It's really exciting. I love it. I enjoy what I do. And that realization, the youngster who walked into Herbert Smith not knowing anything, and the experience and the ups and the downs and the people you've encountered and the things you've learned that you like and the things you've learned you don't, all have moved you to a point in time where you've got the trust of people to be able to execute something complex and business critical like that.
Yeah. And you mentioned trust there, and I know trust is incredibly important to you. You need to trust your peers, you need to trust your team, you also need to trust the partners that you're working with. So in this role, you've got people's best interests at heart, but as you say, you've got a job today, and it's going to put some people's noses out of joint a little bit. How were you able, knowing you as I do and the kind of person you are, you care about people, how were you able to almost part that and then think, well, this is my job and this is what I need to do?
It's never personal. it can't be personal. It has to be business first. And I think that the relationships you build with people when you're making these tough decisions, it always still has to come back to, look, this is not a personal thing. This is a business decision and it's what's right for the business. You get to the point where you have to make these tough decisions.
Yeah.
Build relationships with people that sometimes make those decisions difficult, but also give you the opportunity to rationalize those decisions and to help those individuals move on. Because, you know, I want to build an environment where people want to succeed and where people fit in, where they feel got a voice and all of this kind of culture, which is what I want it to be. But I'm currently on the board. I'm responsible for the business. I have to deliver for the business and that has to come first. And that's what I make sure people understand when they come and work with me and for me, because that's critically important. Nothing that I've ever done has been personal in terms of tough decisions. It's always been with the business head. And I think that if you can communicate that and you make sure that you're being really clear with people, it takes some of that personal angst and some of that kind of this is about me or them out of it. So you can take the them out of it and still support people. You can make tough decisions, but still be supportive and still be there for them and still be an ear for them. It changes what you're doing. You know, it's not about ruling with an iron fist. It's about making people succeed in their own careers, as well as making sure you're delivering for your own business.
Yeah, I think that's great. And I know that you had so many challenges, didn't you, in that role, but you were also being really stretched with time zones because you had the whole remit. And I know that then you made the decision to move on, and the organisation, the firm that you're working for at the moment, is almost everything that you could have dreamed of, the role that you're starting to create now. So share maybe some of the reasons why you joined Wedlake Bell.
So I always wanted to set up a team. And I think this goes all the way back to Anna Jacobs at Slaughter & May, when I saw her create the team around her and the goodwill and the environment that she created. And I didn't realise it then. Yeah. But as I went through my various roles and the various guises of firms I went to and the various CMOs and directors and individuals that I encountered along the way, partners, support, COOs, chairs, you know, managing partners, all of these things, they all shape what you want to be when you grow up. And what I wanted to be...
Have you grown up now, Peter?
When I grew up, I wanted to build my own marketing BD function set it up and create the environment that was so exciting that people wanted to come to work and wanted to be part of something exciting. And Wedlake Bell has... I mean, I've only been there 2 months. I already know I'm in the right place. I already know I've got a seat at the table. I'm on the board. And I'm already building a team that is people coming to me wanting to be part of it. And that's a really nice thing to be experiencing, because I'm going to the market, or I'm in the market, but people are coming to me proactively.
Big volumes, doesn't it? Yeah.
And the interview process at Wedlake Bell, I met some brilliant people, including the managing partner, Martin Arnold, and many others, board members, etc. To a person, the culture and the environment that they presented is playing out. It's absolutely fantastic. I love it. The partnership is great. They want help. They will want to be challenged. They want guidance and they want advice and they want support and they want to move things forwards. And that's my job, is to move the needle and to move it forwards. And to be in that, having an opportunity to do that as well as to create the team to do that.
Yeah.
Is so exciting for me.
And a really rare opportunity, isn't it? So I think it's amazing that it's something you want to do, and you've got this firm that wants to do it with you.
It is. It's unusual because you don't get many firms of this sort of size that don't have a well-established function. Wedlake Bell did have marketing BD, has got marketing BD, but just at a point where the firm is growing at such a pace that the support business parts hadn't kept up. And it wasn't just marketing BD, it was HR, it was IT, and the firms recognised it, and good on them, they're doing something about it. They're investing in those areas, hence why I'm there. And that's in itself is a great thing, is that the firms recognise that it needs to invest in these areas and is doing so, and doing so properly in a committed way, rather than tinkering around the edges. It's basically said to me, come and create a function that is fit for purpose for a modern day law firm in the city that is going places. I'm like, job spec. Thank you very much. That's what you can do.
Everything you would hope for. Exactly. And then, I know that you say you're creating this team and this culture, and I know that's something that is so important for you, and it's something that, you know, has completely come through your entire career. What is it that, you know, makes it so important to you? What is it that makes you want to drive? What do you get from developing people?
I'm a people. I mean, I think we as in marketing and BD are people. It's what we do. We have to influence and we have to lead. And I think that I enjoy seeing people succeed. I want to surround myself with people who are better than me in many cases, who know things that I don't. I'm BD. I don't know PR and comms. So I've got myself a cracking head of PR and comms coming soon. You know, so it's about recognizing where your strengths are, recognizing where you're not so strong, and not being afraid of that.
Yeah.
And then embracing it and thinking, okay, how do I then bring people in who contribute positively to the overall package that we're offering? And I think that seeing people have the opportunity and succeed and be part of that journey is, for me, part of the success of it. It's what it's about. It's about people wanting to come to work and be in an environment where they enjoy it, where they've got a smile, where they're challenged, where they can challenge, and where they're not afraid to do something a bit different.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to, you know, your message before about authenticity, and that you want people to bring their true selves to work, because that's going to be their best selves. And then they're going to feel comfortable about, you know, speaking, having their voice heard. It's creating, you know, again, using the word culture, but it's creating that really special culture, isn't it?
It is. One of my team said to me recently, who's come across from BCRP to Wedlake Bell, she said, it's important that people understand that they can be open with you, Peter, and that they shouldn't be afraid of throwing things at you.
Yeah.
Because what I do is I listen, and then I'll go and I'll discuss it, talk about it, negotiate it, argue it sometimes, but it's a safe place to do this. And that's, you know, there's no idea is a bad idea is a common phrase. But I think making sure that people understand that is really critically important to success. And making them feel free in what they do and what they can say is really important.
Well, I think, as you say, it's easy to say these things, but it's got to be, you've got to see it in practice. People have got to live and breathe it, and then that helps people, you know, make decisions, or, you know, even be able to challenge you around some of the thinking processes, which I know you love. You love a good challenge, don't you?
It's part of the role. We should all challenge. Yeah. There shouldn't be any barriers to people asking and challenging and pressing and pushing back. No barriers whatsoever.
And, you know, diversity and inclusion is really important to you. You know, that's something you and I've talked about in the past as well. So how are you making sure that you've got an inclusive environment? That, again, it's not a tick box on a beautiful glossy brochure, but it's something that the firm live and breathe.
I think it almost comes back to, how did I find myself here? It's really easy to, as you said, have a tick box. You know, what are the things that you would expect? I think if you suppress that bias, then actually you start to open yourself up to different ways of thinking. And there are so many people out there who haven't got the traditional route to where we are. I've got a very traditional route. It would be really easy for me to just go and hire a clone of myself. But what's the point?
Yeah, what value add is that? What benefit? Yeah.
Exactly. Don't just give me more of me. Give me something different. I can do me. So give me something different. And I think that the best way of getting something different is to get a really diverse background, culture, nature, you know, who you are as individuals. Because if we all bring ourselves to work, then you're going to bring that authenticity to work. And by doing that, you're going to have a diverse team.
Yeah, so true. And I just wanted to touch on the LMA as well, because you're such a great organisation and know you're a board member. What was it that pulled you to be so active in the LMA?
So the LMA was, for those who don't know, it initially was a US-based professional development education network. And being at BCLP post-merger, with a big influence from the US, the CMO said, oh, we'd like to set up in Europe. And so my CMO at BCLP, as well as particularly influential, is the CMO of Reed Smith, Sadie Barron.
Yeah.
Got a team together to say, okay, we're going to take this on, and we are going to, for the professional services, legal professional services in Europe, we're going to set up the equipment. This was in 2021. So we've got together a board that is a number of people from firms in the city of London, Germany, Belgium. So we're not just London. So we've got a good mix of people, big firms, Oric, Reed Smith, Linklater, Sidley Austin, BCLP, Wedlake Bell, big firms now. We're going to make sure we say this.
Yeah.
and we went about creating the LMA Europe network. A year down the line, we've got in excess of 260 members, which is unbelievable in terms of the numbers that we've got. And we offer mentor programs, reverse mentoring, 360 mentoring. We offer, gives you access to all of the LMA back catalogue of training, which is either online. You get networking opportunities, which for me is really important, building your network and building that knowledge base.
Yeah.
That is so critical. And so it helps, again, not just be blinkered into your own way of doing things. Mm-hmm. It's so easy to be the robot and to say, we've always done it like this, therefore let's continue doing it like that. Things like the LMA help you challenge your way of thinking. They open your eyes up to different ways of doing things. It gives juniors a great opportunity to learn, particularly at firms where you don't have huge resources in terms of education and investment into individuals. And that's a big thing for me. It's investing in the team for their own personal professional development. That's a massive, massive part of the LMA. And so it brings together this package of how do we move the profession forwards. I think as BD marketing directors and CMOs, we've got an absolute responsibility to our teams and to our people and to the profession, and about how we move the profession forwards. It's been woefully underrepresented in times gone by. And I think the LMA and LMA Europe is a really good way of kicking it forwards and to keep it going and to start actually leading the way rather than always chasing and playing catch up from other sectors.
I think it's fantastic, a really great organisation, and amazing to hear how many members you've already got in such a short period of time, which is great. Why do you think it's so important to network in business development and marketing?
As we get older, we get to know people. I'm getting on now, getting towards the twilight years, let's say, of my career. The juniors who are coming in are so talented. They've got insight, they've got things to bring to the table. And it's really important that you listen to that. And the best way of listening to it is to build a network that isn't just about your peers, it's about those in the sector, in the industry, not just from a learning perspective, but from a leading perspective. So I think from a network perspective, you're going to hate what I'm about to say. I'm building the team so far at Wedlake Bell through my network.
I know you are, Peter. I've got my eye on you.
I know. Now, I may not get it all done like that, but it's really important that you've got the ability to do that. Really important. Yeah. And it doesn't, it's not a no never. And I'm in a fortunate position because I've moved from a big firm. My network is large. And the LMA has helped me with that. The reality of it is that actually the network is all about us as a sector, as an industry, moving it forwards. And I think that if you learn from others, a lot of what we do isn't proprietary, it isn't confidential, it's just process and how we do stuff. And if we can learn from others how we do stuff and do things better, that's not proprietary and it isn't confidential, then why wouldn't we? I'm all for sharing ways to do things to help you at your firm and you in your career. It's not, I'm not competing against you in terms of this piece of work. I'm just saying, well, how about doing it like this? You might, your partners might like that. It doesn't make any odds in terms of winning or losing new business.
Some really great advice there, I think. I think, you know, it's, as you say as well, it's so important if you're going to continue developing a diverse and inclusive culture that you surround yourself by people from all different elements. I think that's great. Yeah. So we've shared lots of really interesting highlights and challenges, but I just thought if we could pull it together, what would you class as being your biggest challenges so far? Because you tend to turn your negatives into positives. So what would you class as being challenges?
I'm an inherently positive, glass half full person.
Glass is overflowing at times, Peter.
Yeah, it can be a bit overwhelming sometimes for some people. However, and the, I mean, that's probably my, part of my challenges. It's recognizing that everybody's not like me.
Yeah.
And that's okay. And that's no reflection on me, and that's no reflection on them. And it's being agile in the way you do things and deal with people, and giving them the moment to be them and not to smother them with me.
Yeah.
So my chat, I mean, I can be loud, I'm overconfident, borderline cocky. We should probably come back to that in a minute. Yeah. But the giving people the ability to have the space is something that I work hard on. Mm-hmm. I say to people, I don't care how busy you think I am, if you need me, I will always find time for you. That's really important. And so the challenge for me is finding the time that is right and deserved for individuals when they need you. And I think that's really, really important. It's something that you have to bring to the top. You can't go, oh, I'll catch you later. And then you forget about them. You've got to bring it to the top and make it a priority when you are leading a team.
I would agree, definitely. And what would you class as being your highlights then?
Highlights, oh my goodness. I mean, there's many of them. I mean, early BLP days were actually a highlight. I mentioned working with the partners, sitting shoulder to shoulder, turning pitch documents even, and seeing things over the line. I remember really early on sitting with one of the transport and asset finance partners overnight, turning a pitch, multi-page pitch, and then pulling me in 2 days later, standing up, shaking me by the hand, telling me we've won a multi-million pound piece of work, and that client going on to be a long-standing client for the firm today still.
Wow, amazing to be involved in that.
Yeah, and that sort of involvement and that sort of contribution lives long in the memory. And it's not just that you got them over the line, it's the experience you went through in doing it. And so the highlights for me are those moments where you partnered with people, where you've not just been told, where you've contributed, where you've led, challenged and shaped to make a difference. And there are so many of those over my career that remain highlights. And I'll look back on with a smile, with fondness and excitement. It gets the fire burning again.
Yeah.
So that is a particular example. But people, seeing people succeed, seeing people move on and seeing people go to great firms and great roles. And you think, I was part of their journey. It's hard losing good people. I hate losing good people. But when you see them going to firms and into roles that are a stretch and that are a challenge, and the firm has looked at them and gone, you can do this, you've got the background, you've got the skills, you know that you've been part of that journey to help them succeed. And that people piece is something that I always work hard on and look at fondly from all the various people I've seen through their careers.
That's really great highlights, Peter. And looking at your words of wisdom, now you mentioned there the difference between being maybe cocky and confident.
Yeah, I really try hard. This is my dad. So my dad always sent me off on my very first interview at Herbert Smith. Very first one, he went, be confident, not cocky. And it sat with me 30 years later.
I love that.
And it's that brash, loud person that you can be. You know, confidence is fine. Cockiness is really hard to lose. So you have to earn the trust and be confident. If you think you've got trust and you haven't, you're borderline come across cocky.
Yeah.
I've always lived and breathed by the be confident, not cocky. And the team have heard it like, oh my goodness, they hear it all the time.
That's but your mantra. It's
sat with me. And, you know, you can the confidence and the things you bring to negotiations and to interviews and whatever, they develop. And you learn what you need to suppress and what you need to bring to the front and what you need to be really wary of, because it keeps coming out. And I think it's a good thing to live by. I can't stand cocky people. You know, earn my trust. Don't tell me how good you are. Show me how good you are.
Yeah, that's good. And what other bits of advice would you give them? Words of wisdom.
Words of wisdom. Push yourself. Don't fall into the rut. I fell into a rut. Don't do that. It delays your career. Realize when you're ready to move and push for it. Don't be afraid to move. Don't be afraid to stretch yourself and go for something that you kind of a bit out of your comfort zone on, because actually you will generally rise to the challenge and then you'll move on and it will move you on through your career. So I think that's something particularly good. And take those opportunities, take the opportunity to do something that you're not used to doing. Be open. I talk about not being afraid. I think it's okay not to know the answers. We don't know everything. I go back to a partner when I was at A&O, and I was in a meeting with him, and the client asked him a question, and the partner just said, there's something I need to talk about that before I give the answer. Just let me give it to you once and give it to you right. Walked out the meeting. He said to me, I've got no idea what that was all about. Let's go and find out. So he kind of he opened up to me and said, I don't know. He didn't know. He had the answer of, oh, I can park you over there and not, you know, I've got this, but it was open enough for me to say, oh, look, I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah. Really,
it's okay not to know the answer.
Yeah, that's good. Well, thank you. I have to say, it's been such a fascinating conversation. I'm definitely going to take your dad's words away with me about being confident and not cocky. I think that's a really good way of a descriptive way of thinking about development, isn't it? And there's been so many takeaways from the meeting today. So thank you so much, Peter. It's been an absolute pleasure.
No, it's been lovely. Hopefully it's been helpful. It's been lovely to chat to you, Nicky. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you.